David Price.
Over 7 wins and 2 draws from Stockport, Jamie Delchild Quinn. And his opponent got him in the red corner in camouflage shorts. He also weighed in at 9 stones, 12 pounds. He brings to the ring a perfect professional record of 8 wins from 8 contests. By way of knockout, from Halifax, Jimmy the Fist Fest! Your technical foul is very good in the game. Your referee is Mr. Phil Edwards of Preston.
Right, Dave, look, the first fight of the night, we've got Jimmy the Fist first. He fights out of Huddersfield with Chris Aston. He's 8-0. And we've got Jamie Quinn, the devil child. He's had over 100 fights now, one of the toughest journeymen on the scene.
First of all, these are two of my favourite trainers, two favourite men in the scene, you know, Chris Aston and
Joe Penn.
I love them both.
Go on, why do you love them?
Just characters of the game, you know. They've been around it so long, like 40, 50 plus years, you know, if you count their amateur experience themselves, you know. It's just fantastic, isn't it? And I've been lucky to spend a bit of time with both, and they're just great. And as for the fighters, Jamie Quinn must be one of the best trainers in the country, you know, him, Jordan Granham, William Warburton, you know, and they're all with Joe as well, so, yeah.
We've got another great one on there on here tonight, Louis Van Pooch as well.
Yeah.
Now, Quinn is one of the toughest guys around. Like I say, he's been in with everyone pretty much. He's taken on all comers. He's even taken the Sun newspaper on, so give him fair credit. Jimmy the Fist here, he said in the pre-fight amble that he was coming out. He was going to be on the front foot, and I think we're going to see a bit of a scrap tonight.
The thing with Quinn is, he's very tough, obviously, don't get me wrong. The amount of fights that had been stopped, I believe, once. I'm not sure if that was a cut or whatever, but you've got to be very good as well. He was a good amateur. He's a very good fighter. He's very clever, you know, and he's adapted his game, so he's very good defensively. Obviously, he could have a go. He could win a few, but he's here for a job. This is his full-time job, you know. He's here to defend. He's here to get through the rounds, and he's here to taking the minimal amount of damage in return, and he's mastered the art, really.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. Now, Dave, in your early career, you fought some of these sort of tough journeymen coming up. You know, what makes a good journeyman?
Well, it's different as heavyweight because, you know, you do punch hard. There's not really. When I first started out, there was no English heavyweight journeyman. You know, there's a few knocking about now, but there was all foreigners and they couldn't take a knock. To be honest, it was absolutely useless. So you either banged them out or you got the odd tough one that was good. So it's different, but what makes a good journeyman? A good journeyman has to be very fit all the time. You fight every week, you've got to be super, super fit. And Quinn is, look at his body, man, he's sculpted from stone.
Yeah.
So you've got to be very fit.
He's going to love that when he watches this back.
And it's a shame about his face. But you know, but you've got to be super tough.
Someone
super
had to
fit.
Say it.
But you've got to be able to fight. People think these journeymen with 90 losses are useless. You have got to be an exceptionally good fighter to get through 20, 30 fights, never mind 100, especially when you're on the... You're there to get beat by decent kids as well. So I've got the most respect for these fighters.
And Jimmy, he comes in the ring today. He's the oldest guy on the card. He's 38 years old, or 38 years young, I should say. But he said, you know, as long as you live a healthy life, a good, clean life, then you can go on boxing. Obviously, we've got the Mayweathers, the Bernard Hopkins, who probably can still come back now if they wanted to. But, you know, he loves his boxing. He's dedicated to his boxing. And he is on the front foot, you know, like he said he would be so far.
He looks in great shape, you know, for 38. He looks fantastic. As long as you stick to your level, whatever your level is, you know, Jimmy's not Bernard Hopkins or Flo Mayweather, obviously, but, you know, at this level, you know, he's winning. He's stopped a few as well, looking at his record, you know, so you can see he's very fit. You know, not everyone needs to be a world beater, as I know myself, you know. He looks very capable, he's fit. The main thing is he's fit, you know, obviously, I've done it myself, I've turned up not in shape. He's fit and he's here to do his job, and he's trying, you know, he really is trying to get Jamie Quinn out of there. I'm not sure it's going to be possible, but... But yeah, who cares how old he is? He's still able to perform.
Absolutely, he's got a real good following as well, and a bit like yourself. Well, you've got a real cult following, haven't you? But you know, I suppose what a lot of the boxing public want to know is, you know, you mentioned yourself there about in the past you haven't trained, so to speak. You know, you've always relied on that natural ability to have a scrap. So, you know, for this fight in February, are we going to see you put in a proper camp?
Yeah, of course. You know, I've trained for the last few. The prize fight, the training went wrong, but it wasn't a lack of effort. But, you know, the best fights I've had, Bracamonte.
Great fight, that was.
I've not really trained. I've trained probably 3 or 4 out of 24. So it's foolish of me, one, obviously. But yeah, moving forward, every fight I have now, every fight I could have could be the last of my career, you know. I've, I've been a pro 7 years and there's been some growlers in there, you know. I've been out of my depth, which is even harder than growlers, you know. 50-50 growler, you gain some back. Ortiz, White, Yoker, you know, it was all one way traffic. The same with Price, I guess. So
actually, yeah. I remember the one against White in Leeds. It wasn't all one-way traffic. I mean, obviously, he beat you, you know, soundly, so to speak. But you done well in the fight. In we go into round number two. We've got Jimmy the Fist on the front foot again against Jamie Quinn. We're over here at the Hilton Deansgate for the Contender VIP final show. Of course, the show is dedicated to the memory of Phil Martin, a Manchester boxing training legend who passed away 25 years ago. Good uppercut there on the inside from Jimmy the Fist. He's opened up a bit more now. He's putting a bit more weight behind the shots.
Yeah, it's very interesting to hear the Phil Martin story. Obviously, I'm from Doncaster in Sheffield, so Brendan Ingle, obviously, the man around there. Obviously, I was fortunate enough to spend a lot of time with Brendan. I trained there. It looks like Phil Martin had the same kind of impact around this area. So, you know, and if he was even a 10th of the man, Brendan, well, what a man he was, you know. So if Phil Martin was doing a similar thing around here, almost respect him for doing that.
Yeah, his impact and what he did with particularly the fighters of his era, but even to this day, a lot of fighters still accredit their, you know, what they do in the trainings. A lot of trainers use his techniques, etc. Yeah,
it's the same with Bren, you know. Look at all his fighters, you know, Glenn Rhodes, Ryan Rhodes, you know.
Yeah.
They've all got Johnny Nelson in a different extent, gone onto TV, you know. Brendan could do it all, you know. I was showering at Brendan. Look at me now, I don't shut up.
I love it when Naz is on TV.
Oh, God. Yeah,
I love it.
That's why he's kept off there, because we all enjoy it too much.
Good body shot there. That's what that see, one in under the elbow, didn't
that's,
he?
That's what you see out of Quinn is, because, you know, in a four-round fight, you know, you're going to get it at some point, and you have to be tough. You know, you can be as clever as you want, make him miss as many times as you want. Over four rounds, like there, that jab there, them jabs hurt, but he's tough enough just to say, you know what, yeah, have that one, son. It's all right, you're not going to stop me anyway.
Yeah, he's literally is, as you mentioned, as tough as they come. He's been in with some real punches as well.
Yeah, he's been in with everybody, but the thing is, he's not just a tough man, like, he's good, you know. At this point of his career, he's ingrained in him. Get through the four rounds, don't get cut, don't take too much stick, get through the four rounds. So I imagine, you know, if his career went a different way, if he was a ticket seller, if he was a bigger puncher, you know, he'd won an area title for definite, and who knows beyond, you know, same with Warburton and others, but he's a good fighter, Quinn. You have to be to have 100 and whatever he's on now, 104,
105 fights, something like that. And the action's not the rip-roaring pace that we were expecting, but still it's a decent pace.
The thing with Quinn is, like, if you get Jimmy first on the back foot, it's half the job done for him, you know, because you know punches are going backwards. So, you know, if I was a journeyman, some people say I am, but if I were a proper one, week in, week out, get him on the back foot, you know, the job's half done. You take half the power away from him.
Yeah.
You know, you take a bit of the, you know, you get a bit excited getting there. You think, oh, God, he's here to get it. You know, there's a punch bag that's going to go through him. So, you know, if Quinny can get him on the back foot, it really would be half the job done. But Jimmy first, like you say, he has come to put a bit of a show on.
Yeah, and he's starting to use the jab a bit more now and just show a few different variations to his game. He's not just walking in aimlessly. He's trying that right uppercut as well.
Also, I've got Danny Morolachenko, you know.
Yes,
the
I do. Your young protege.
And the thing is, when I train him, I learn more now through... I say things to him all the time that I don't do myself. Things like, you have to jab, Danny. You know, even if you're stronger than the kid, you have to jab, because if you can't hit him with the left hand, you're not going to hit him with the right hand. So if Jimmy comes in with Quinny here and he's going to hit him with a lead right hand, and even worse than that, an overhand right, if you're not hitting him with your left, you're not hitting him with your right, hit him with your left first. If your left lands, you can throw your right. That's what I say, Danny. If you throw your right without your left, come back to the corner soon, because you're going to get
I think that's what I was screaming at you when you was fighting Webb. Jab a bit more. Instead, you just loaded up a big right hand, didn't you?
However, though, the left hook went in the body first.
Yeah,
know,
it did, to be fair.
I know I could hit him, so people think I'm useless, but I might be in some people's senses, but there's a bit of brain there, I think, I hope.
The room's gone silent there, Dave. No, I mean, people are looking forward to seeing you back out in February, and of course, on a Kell Brook undercard as well. It'd be good to see Kell Brook back in the ring.
Yeah, Kell, I'm not sure if going off with Kell, to be honest. I don't know, but hopefully he gets a win and, you know,
moves on to a big fight.
Yeah, I'm not even bothered about the car fight anymore. I think that ship sailed. But
past its sell-by date, isn't it?
You know, if he comes out and performs and he can make 10-7 or whatever, he can fight a Crawford. I guess he's looking for opponents because, you know, the TV network stuff over in America. So I don't know.
Absolutely. Jamie Quinn just landed a good jab there in the centre of the ring. Gave each other a little smile and a wink. I think they've got a lot of respect for each other, these boys. But they're going to start up in the tempo now as they come into the third round.
Yeah, Quinn is keeping him honest a bit. You know, he's keeps catching with the odd one. It's all kidology, you know, and mind games. You know, give him a little nod of the edge. Yeah, you're not hurting me. And he's probably not, to be fair. But
he's had a lot of success, Jimmy, with the right uppercut on the inside.
It's funny because, you know, you watch these against Journeyman, and some people look $1 million against them and you think, ooh, when they step up, they're going to be good. But, you know, when they start getting it out, they can't hack it. For me, Jimmy first here, he's not setting the world alight against Jamie Quinn because, you know, he's not the prettiest of boxers, but he looks super fit. He looks like he could do this all night. So it'll be interesting when he steps up 6-8, someone who fights back. I think you see the best of him then.
Yeah, I mean, I've watched him train at Northside, Jamie Quinn, and he hits bags round after round after round, never stops.
Yeah. Yeah, he's super fit.
Then he gets a chippy on the way back home. You know, that's what you like to see, you know, these good honest journeymen. But he's on the front foot now, and that's a good body shot there, and Jimmy's waving him on.
It's all kidology, you know, and after a few fights, you come to realise, how much Jimmy had now eight, you know, when he has another eight, he'll not even acknowledge that, he'll just try and hit him again. You know, sometimes, I just think if I hit him and they do something, I think that might have hurt that, let's hit him there again, so let's just
test. What did that body shot feel like against Lucas Brown?
Well, it probably hits him more than me, like. But
you know, you looked almost half surprised and half delighted.
Well, you know, it was the plan. The plan was to the body. He's an old man, to be fair. He's 40-year-old. So, you know, as you know, when you reach 40, you slow down a bit and you can't handle the same stick you once could. So.
Yeah. I've not reached 40 yet. Is that what you're trying to say?
No, I'm just saying.
Tying each other up. This is the first time in the fight, really. They've had a bit of a clinch there.
Yeah, you know,
the referee's not had to be involved, has he?
He's going for that wide right hook. It's one of my pet hates, that lead right hook. I don't like it. I don't think it's a good shot because it doesn't hurt, to be honest.
Yeah.
It doesn't actually hurt.
To generate power off it, isn't it?
Yeah, it's an arm shot, basically. It's basically a forearm shot. He's swinging it with your forearm. Like.
There is one fighter who does land it well, though. That's Canelo, and he does manage to generate some torque on it.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm not a massive Canelo fan, to be honest.
Oh, fair enough.
I think there's a lot of boxers out there that, you know, over time have become less and less of a fan of as a boxer because, you know what I'm saying?
No, are you going to tell me?
Well, you know.
Okay, let's leave it there just in case.
When you see bits of, Quinny here, and if that jabbing, you just think, he's a really good fighter.
No, he is. And he can move off an angle as well.
Yeah, he's a really good fighter, to be honest.
How are we scoring this one, Dave?
Well, it's 30-27,
yeah,
Jimmy First.
To Jimmy First, yeah.
Even if he were losing, it's still 30-27, Jimmy First.
That's what I love about you, Dave. Just say what you think, basically.
Yeah, I see so many scorecards on Sky and on BT. Just think, what is this judge watching?
I know, there's been a lot of that recently, haven't there?
Do the one with Massey and Riatpoor, like, it was a really close fight, but to score it six rounds one way or
that was other. That was the most recent one, wasn't it? That was a Thursday night.
Johnny Ryder, Callum Smith.
Yeah, what was a 117-111 card, wasn't it?
And I had personally done my running by four, so
right.
That's a 10-round swing on
I've
my
I've spoke
opinion.
To people who have it one way. I've spoke to people that have Callum winning by two or three rounds as well. So, but having it 117-111, that was a wide score margin, wasn't it?
You know, a lot of people have done Ryder winning by one or two, or Callum Smith winning by one or two, and, you know, it,
yeah.
But
yeah.
When you get one winning by six, it just sickens you off a bit watching it as a fan.
Yeah. That's what we've got Twitter for, isn't it?
Yeah, I guess so.
In we go into the fourth and final round. We're over here at the Hilton Deansgate in Manchester. I've got the great pleasure of being joined by Dave Allen. I'm sure you're enjoying what he's got to say. Jimmy the Fist, he is on the front foot again, using that jab a little bit more. Chris Astor's probably told him, get that jab working a bit more, keep Quinny honest.
To hit a man like Quinn, you have got to test him up with a jab. The amount of times he's been hit with a right hand, you probably count on one hand in 104 fights. He's super clever. And
I think the only person I've ever seen give Quinny a bit of trouble was Sam Maxwell.
And Sam Maxwell, you know, boxed Lomachenko twice, GB amateur. He's a big lump and all, you know. He's a light middleweight now, isn't he? So, you know, Jimmy the Fist first, you know, looks like a super fit, well-conditioned fighter. I'd like to see him in a fight that's a bit more competitive, over a bit 6 or 8, and I guess at 38, see what he's got, you know, because he can't have too much left in the tank at that age. But you know, you're better off knowing than not knowing. So I'd like to see him step up in his next fight. I think he's ready for a 6 or 8 with someone that'll come to win, and I think you might see the best out of him.
You mentioned about earlier on about having a good following. That really does help in boxing. He's got a great following, loads of great supporters. I mean, there's quite a few in here tonight, but there's loads supporting him on social media and tuning in. Oh, that's a good right hook there from Quinny.
But you do see the odd bits a little bit of class out of Quinny, where you think, you know what, if you could have sold tickets or you are a puncher, I'm not sure. It's usually one or the other. When you go down the journeyman route, you're either you're either you're not being much of a puncher, or you can't sell your tickets, or you want to make a few quid, because he'd been one of the most current British champions, Quinny, yeah, doing what he's doing. But yeah, yeah. You see a little bits of class and you think, yeah, he could have easily done something, mate, you know.
I hear you. You've had some nice paydays, haven't you? We're not going to go into it, but
I don't like to brag or help, but when I land the O2, it weren't bad.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Well, you know what, Aki, I've actually been quite sensible. I used to be a gambling lunatic and all the rest of it, but I've got two kids now, you know, and I've had to rein it in, and I want to see Danny and Liam do the best they're doing with their boxing. Jamie McFarlane's coming down to train with me as well. I'm doing all sorts, you know. I'm fighting myself just basically to now to fund my other honestly activities, but that sounds more exciting than it is.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to finding out about these other activities.
Well.
And the action continues here. We're in the fourth and final round of this four-round bout.
The quieter this fight is, the better it is for Quinn, you know. The quieter it is, the better. He's not here to win. He's here to do four rounds, taking the least amount of damage possible. And he's done a good job, you know. This is journeyman 101 stuff from him. I like to watch it, though.
Yeah, I like to watch it. He's had a go in spells, and four rounds completed. Yeah. And this actually is a rematch, you know. They have actually fought each other once before. Yeah, they fought for I think it was Jimmy the Fist's first. Yeah, but it was his pro debut. Yeah. So they fought then. So I think it's a routine win there, isn't it, for Jimmy?
Yeah, it's job done for both, really. You know, Jimmy first. He'll learn a bit again, because Quinny does little things. He caught him with that uppercut. Jimmy first has to think, maybe that's a bigger puncher, a bigger fella, you know, and might hear that. Let's not get hit with him.
Dave, it's been a pleasure having you commentate with me, man.
I've really enjoyed it. Big up Ryan Oliver, Danny Morrell, you know, Liam Carrigan, the full gang.
The full gang.
Everyone at home watching.
I understand you're leaving me now. You've got better things to do.
Well, you know, I can come back at any point. You shout, mate.
I'll give you a shout later on.
Cheers, mate.
Right, I appreciate that, mate. Really appreciate that. Dave Allen, cheers.
Contest 40 points to 36 in favour of your winner from Halifax, Jimmy the Fist Burst.
Good evening, I'm Joe Streeter reporting for BBTV, backstage at the Contender VIP show in Manchester. We're joined by Jimmy the Fist first. Congratulations on a solid victory, a tough fight, I thought.
Thank you.
How do you assess your performance?
Honestly, I felt a little bit flat tonight. It's a big stage, bigger than where I've been before. And the nerves did get to me a little bit.
Yep.
And Jamie Quinn's a solid opponent, you know, and he does tuck up, and it's quite hard to get in there and get them angles. I mean, I caught him with a couple of nice uppercuts, caught him one nice to the body. And I am, you know, quite a bit of a pressure fighter, but try to, you know, box a little bit more. But I did feel a bit flat tonight, I'll be honest with you. Maybe the nerves got to me, I'm not too sure, but again, credit to Jamie Quinn, you know, he's a tough guy and he does what he has to do, doesn't he? You know, he's a tough lad, but all in all, got the win, so I can't be too disappointed on an amazing night, you know. So,
I mean, a very honest assessment, but you still managed to win every round, so you must be doing something right.
Yeah, thank you.
I noticed the body punching was, I was ringside, it was devastating, it was hurting my ribs watching from ringside some of them shots, really drilling them home. How much of an asset is that when it comes to like unlocking cagier opponents like Jamie Quinn?
Yeah, I think, you know, working to the body, it's like, you know, chopping a tree down, isn't it, and slowing people down. I know that I caught him with a nice one left up to the body, and then it was, you know, then I started going to the right a little bit more, and he just said to me afterwards, he goes, you caught me really, he goes, I didn't want to show it, but I sort of like got on my bike a little bit, and he did say, because the ring was quite small, he was struggling a little bit to, he said I was cutting the ring off quite well, so, you know, pleased in some parts, but again, I have got, you know, better fights, and when people come to, you know, when people are throwing more shots at me, then there's going to be more openings and, you know, hopefully more knockouts to come and whatnot. But hey, listen, you can't take anything away from Jamie Quinn, top lad, you know, and he's such a nice guy as well, you know.
I know in the last round you really upped it. You stepped up, turned it up a notch and started unloading, and he said to me as well that he really started to feel the pressure in the last round. Did you feel you had more in the tank? Do you feel, you know, you're more of a 6-round fighter, an 8-round fighter will excel in the longer rounds?
Yeah, I mean, I've done 3 6-rounders so far. Two of them have gone the distance, one of them I finished it in the 4th round or something. But without a doubt, I mean, I wasn't really out of breath then. And I have got an engine. I mean, I'm older, but I have got a good engine on me. So bring me, I want to step up now to 8 rounds, 8 and 10s. And that's where, you know, I feel that, you know, I'll, you know, my engine will pay dividends.
And so is that what we can, is that what you're looking forward to in 2020?
Yeah, definitely, you know, it's time to, you know, step it up a little bit. I don't know what they're doing with the contender VIP, whether there's going to be the lightweights, because I am actually a lightweight. I don't know whether that's going to be. I'd go for that. I want to fight unbeaten fighters now. It's now's the time. It's time to, you know, step it up a bit. Maybe an ultimate boxer, that'd suit me. You know, three-rounders on the night. It'll
hot,
suit me.
Pace,
it'll suit me. You know, I've got an engine and all my high pace.
It's interesting you say that. Like the tournament formats, they bring out the best in fighters like yourselves. Is that you're definitely looking to get on that's where you want to get on in a 2020?
Or you know, just, you know, step it up to an 8-rounder and then and, you know, for an intercontinental belt or an area title, something like that, or one of those. You know, I just need that step up now. You know, it is time. But I'm flipping privileged to be on a show like this. You know, it's an amazing night. Contender, you know, thank you to Mike LeGalaz. Thank you to everyone who's come over from Yorkshire. People, I've got friends from Manchester that have come out to support me. So thank you to everyone, you know, that have come out and supported me.
Paying tribute to a boxing icon in Phil Martin as well, which makes it all the more special as well.
Yeah, it really does. And it's such a swanky night, you know. Mike LeGalaz got me a room. Here, so I've had a bath earlier, nicely chilled out. So I'm gonna go. I've got a tux, I've got my suit, and I'm gonna go and gonna go and have a glass of champagne and enjoy the night and enjoy Christmas.
I might see you out in Manchester tonight then.
I'll probably just stick around. But yeah, you might do. Yeah, I'll have a few. Steady away.
It's always a pleasure to call your fights as well, and I look forward to seeing you in 2020.
Thank you.
Nice one.
Lovely
to catch you around.
Thank you. Thanks.
How did you think it went?
Well, I knew what to expect with Jimmy. He's a very busy lad. I fought him before on his debut, and that was a really hard fight. Like. Again, I thought it was a 6-rounder, to be honest, and so I've got down and said it's a 4-rounder. Like, to be honest, I'm quite glad it was. Like, I was getting a bit of an hiding in that last round then. Like, but I think I did all right. I knew what to expect with Jimmy. Like, he comes forward a lot. Like, he has got power. So I knew not to take any risks. Like, because I've got a fight coming up in Bermuda on the 18th of January, so if like holiday, like out a bit. So if I got stopped today, then that would have been off the cards. So I just knew I had to be careful, because like I say, like he has got impact quite an hard punch, so I weren't taking no chances. But so everything went to plan really. I didn't come expecting a win. Like I'd thought it'd be my last fight before Christmas.
So I noticed the body punching was a big theme of that fight.
Yeah,
there was some big body shots being exchanged on both parts. I guess you noticed that as well.
Well, he winded me a few, especially in the last round when I was already tired a bit. Like I tried letting a few go myself, but like the first fight I remember, like I caught him a few body shots, but still he just kept coming forward like, and I think I did all right as far as getting out of there in one piece.
What more can you tell us about the Bermuda fight? When is it? What show is it on?
I think they fly out on the 18th. It's a bigger show, Bermuda versus England, and it's a pro-am show. So I've got an opponent lined up. So I think we're out there for 10 days. So we only fight once. But I think we've got to get there early for the interviews and everything. Like, and recover
nice
from our jet lag. And then a few days on the beach for free of charge.
I look forward to seeing you in Bermuda. All the best for the future, and have a great Christmas.
Thank you, mate. Cheers.
Thanks ever so much.
Cheers.
See you.